St. Mary's College, Team One, Take One, Chapter Four, Analyzing Financial Statements and Action.
I'm Kevin.
Hi, I'm Matt.
I'm Vinny.
And we're going to be talking about Chapter Four, Analyzing Financial Statements. So I don't think we really have to go through the learning objectives. Do we, Professor? Okay. So, perspectives on financial statement analysis. So there's three perspectives that you can take in terms of the financial statement analysis. That's of the stockholders, managers, and creditors. For the stockholders, their focus is primarily on the net cash flows, risk, rate of return, and the market value of the firm's stock. Managers focus on rate of return, efficient use of assets, controlling costs, increasing net cash flows, increasing the market value of the firm's stock, and job security. And creditors focus on the predictability of revenues and expenses, the ability to meet short-term obligations, the ability to make loan payments as scheduled, and also the avoidance of changes in risk. So basically, all three are just focusing on what would help make them the most money, what would help them their career the most. So some guidelines for financial statement analysis. First, you have to understand what perspective you're going to be taking, so whether it be the stockholder, the manager, or the creditor. Using audited financial statements and using 3 to 5 years of statements to enable trend analysis is important, as well as benchmarking your analysis with to competitors of a similar size with similar products and services, so that you know, you can compare with the other companies. So common size financial statements. So this basically means that you're showing the dollar amount of each item as a percentage of a reference value. So a common size balance sheet, it may use total assets as the reference value, and each item would be expressed as a percentage of total assets. And a common size income statement may use net sales as the reference value, again, each item being expressed as a percentage of but this time it's of net sales. So the common size balance sheet, just diving into that a little bit, it standardizes the amount in a balance sheet account by converting the dollar value of each item to its percentage of total assets. So the dollar values on a regular balance sheet provide information on the number of dollars associated with a balance sheet account. And percentage values on a common size balance sheet provide information on the relative size or importance of the dollars associated with a balance sheet account. So this is what basically a common size balance sheet looks like, this being for the Diaz Manufacturing. And again, it will show historical records like that as and you know, percentage of assets. The percentage is important, of course. And so on the other hand, a common size income statement. So the most useful way to prepare a common size income statement is expressing each account as a percentage of net sales. So not assets, but net sales on this one, because it's dealing with income. Each expense is interpreted as the cost incurred to generate $1 in sales. And so, again, here is for the same manufacturing company, a income statement. So you can see over the course of 3 years it's showing here, and the values as a percentage of net sales. Financial ratios and firm performance. So financial ratios establish a common reference point across firms, even though the numerical value of the reference point will differ from firm to firm. So by using ratios, it makes it easier to compare performance between large firms and small firms, because obviously the finances are going to be very different between, you know, large and small. But as a comparison point in terms of relative finance, you can compare this way. Also, ratios make it easier to confirm the current and historical performance of a single firm as the firm changes over time. So even if you're your firm is much, much bigger 5 years later, you can still compare to how, you know, financially you are performing compared to what you did about 5 years ago. And I will be stepping off now.
All right. Short-term liquidity ratios. Liquidity ratios indicate a firm's ability to pay short-term obligations with short-term assets without endangering the firm. In general, higher ratios are a favorable indicator. This is the equations right here. Current assets over current liabilities, etc. This is a ratio for time trend analysis. Pretty long. Efficiency ratios. Efficiency ratios indicate a firm's ability to use assets to produce sales. These are also called turnover ratios. In general, higher numbers are a favorable indicator. For days sales and inventory, however, a lower number is favorable. And here's some more efficiency ratios. Turnover ratios. And then leverage ratios indicate whether a firm is using the appropriate amount of debt financing. In general, higher ratios indicate greater potential return and greater bankruptcy risk. For the following ratios, the higher number generally indicates less bankruptcy risk and possibly lower potential return. Probability ratios indicate whether a firm is generating adequate profit from its assets. In general, higher ratios indicate better performance. And here's some more profitability ratios. Market value indicators. Market value ratios indicate how the market is valuing a firm's equity. Higher ratios indicate greater shareholder wealth.
I'll introduce the DuPont system. Diagnostic tool for evaluating a firm's financial health. Uses related ratios that link the balance sheet and income statement based on two equations that connect a firm's ROA and ROE. Used by management and shareholders to understand factors that drive the ROE. ROA and ROE equations for you. And here is shown two basic strategies to earn a higher ROA. So Tiffany and Burberry are a couple of our examples, as well as Whole Foods and Walmart. Here's the DuPont equation. Shows that the ROE is driven by profitability, operating efficiency, and the amount of leverage debt. Some relations in the DuPont system. And selecting a benchmark. A ratio or ratio analysis is relevant only when compared to an appropriate benchmark. So you have trend analysis, industry analysis, and peer group analysis. Peer group ratios for DS manufacturing. Also shows liquidity ratios, efficiency ratios, all that good stuff.
And you're going to be using the peer group ratios at the end of the semester. We're going to be doing Goldman Sachs, so we'll be taking the financial ratios for Goldman Sachs, comparing them to, who should we use? Wells Fargo, JP Morgan, B of A, what do you think?
B of A.
Maybe. I would say JP Morgan. I think they hate each other. And they're their direct competitor, even though Goldman's only around $1 trillion in assets, and JP Morgan's like 2.2 trillion, so they're double. But I think from a competitive standpoint, that's the direct competitor. And then what we're going to do is we're going to use the assets of the banks, sum them up, divide them back to get the weights, and then we'll calculate a weighted average for the individual ratios to come up with a peer group ratio. And then we'll compare the peer group ratio to the Goldman Sachs ratios, and if their Goldman's is significantly better than the peer group, we'll give it an excellent condition, good, or above average, or below average, or poor. Again, these banks are best run banks, so usually their financial ratios are probably above average, good in most cases, and excellent in some cases. So the overall financial condition and position of the firm based on your financial ratio analysis, in most cases will probably be good for these types of firms. And that's the underlying accounting financial ratio analysis that you conduct before you do any kind of securities analysis on a firm. You go look at their financial ratios. Okay, thank you.
More chart. Peer group analysis for Diaz Manufacturing 2017. So we have ratios, asset ratios, and profit margins. Limitations of financial statement analysis. Weaknesses of financial statement analysis. Not an exact science. It relies on accounting data and historical costs. And few guidelines or principles for determining whether a ratio is high or low, or is a reason for confidence or for concern.
All right, so I'm gonna guide you through some of the first questions. So why is it important to look at a firm's historical financial statements? Well, it's important to do the analysis over a 3 to 5 year period, like we said, in order to see trends. So is the firm improving, is it worsening, or is it staying the same? What is the purpose of the DuPont system of analysis, like we just talked about? It's to determine a company's financial health. So it breaks the ROE, return on investment, into three parts: profit margin, total asset turnover, and financial leverage, which is the equity multiplier. So if the ROE is unsatisfactory, the DuPont identity helps locate which part of the business is underperforming. What is the equation for ROA in the DuPont system? So it's ROA equals net income over net sales times net sales over total assets. Or you could write it the other way on the bottom. What are the three major shortcomings of return on investment? It does not consider the size of the initial investment or the size of future cash payments. It ignores risk, which risk is obviously something that's very important. It also does not directly consider the cash flow involved in the business decision-making process. And explain how the DuPont identity allows us to evaluate a firm's performance. So it leads to the measurement of a firm's return on equity. So there's three areas of performance. The first is the firm's operation efficiency is measured by the net profit margin. The second being the firm's efficiency in managing its assets is reflected in the asset turnover ratio. And the third being the impact of financial leverage is shown by the equity multiplier. So these three areas of performance are what you should study, obviously. And you can analyze the strengths and weaknesses of the firm's performance based on those three measures. What are the limitations on traditional financial statement analysis? Since it is not based on book values, which is historical data, it may not reflect the firm's true economic condition, and there is a lack of economic underpinning for much of the decision rules. And then list some of the problems that financial analysts confront when analyzing financial statements. So five big problems here. Multiple business lines, inflation adjustments, globalization, seasonality, and different accounting principles, all of which are difficult, are important, but difficult to face against.
So why is the ROE a more appropriate proxy for stockholder value maximization for some firms than for others? The basis on which any business or investment decisions are evaluated must include the size, timing, and uncertainty in future cash flows. ROE considers neither the risk of the cash flows nor the size of the initial investment or future cash flows from that investment, while the ROE and shareholder wealth are correlated. This is still a problem in the large, well-diversified companies with resources from multiple sources. Smaller firms have fewer resources and sources can better correlate their ROE to shareholder wealth. And this is the equation on how to get earnings per share right here.
Profitability ratios. So here's an example here, internet sales, net income, cost of goods sold, and EBIT. And then the DuPont equation here, a lot of letters, a lot of numbers, a lot of percentages, and how.
The ROA is equal to, right? Rate of.
Precise.
Right?
Yeah.
Awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yeah, exactly.
No motion. You explained it better than he could.
Cool. Yeah. Didn't know too much about the DuPont equation, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
So we have Carter Inc. up here, ROE.
In the actual text, it will tell you basically all of the aspects of the equation that you need to know. So the ROE, return on investment, 23.1% right here. So you plug it in the equation. The PM, which is the profit margin, 4.9%. Total asset turnover ratio, 2.6 times. Here you have 2.6 times for TATO. And so you take the ROA equals the 4.9% here times the TATO, 2.6 times, which you get this number right here. And then, so for the peer group, it tells you basically you would plug in the same things in the equation, 23.1, 5.3% profit margin, and the total asset turnover ratio 3 times. Plug that in to the equation, and then you get the 1.81 here. And so at the bottom you have the result, basically, that Carter matched its peer group's return on investments by using a higher degree of financial leverage as indicated by its higher equity multiplier. So if the equity multiplier is higher, obviously, like in the example, it's going to be. It means that you have a higher degree of financial leverage. And then there's just like look again. That's the actual equation. So. ROE equals net profit margin times total asset turnover times equity multiplier, and this is how you find the equity multiplier, total asset turnover, and net profit margin. So we'll leave it on that for now, just so we can write it down. Thank you.
one saw them.
Yep. How do I...
And what happened to those guys?
One of them's sick, and another, I think the other one dropped.
Pretty sure.
So how do I get from this computer onto...
which one are you...
Because I accidentally put it on this one.
Oh, did you? Okay, and you just push the button. Make sure you study the problems and stuff like that so you can walk us through the mechanics instead of like skipping over.
All right, so I did chapter 5. My name is Alex Banks, and it has to do with the time value of money. So what is the time value of money? It's the choice between spending today and spending tomorrow. A dollar can be spent now or invested to earn interest today. A dollar invested in earning interest increases wealth and the ability to consume later. The rate of interest is termed as the trade-off between consumption today and investing for the future. The time value of money, which is TVM, is the difference between a dollar in hand today and a dollar promised in the future. So a dollar today is worth more than a dollar in the future because we can earn interest on today's dollar. So the future value versus the present value. The future value is, measures the value of an investment after it earns interest for one or more periods. The present value measures the current value of future cash flows discounted at the appropriate interest rate. And compounding is the process of increasing cash flows to a future value, and discounting is the process of reducing future cash flows to a present value. Future value and compounding. So the future value equation is future value sub n equals the present value times 1 plus I to the n. And future value, FV is obviously future value, PV is present value, I represents the rate of interest per period, N is the number of periods, and the 1 plus I to the N is the future value factor. So here's question problem 5.1, has to do with future value. Chuck Tomkovic is planning to invest $25,000 today in a mutual fund that will provide a return of 8% each year. What will be the value of the investment in 10 years? Here's the answer. Basically, use the equation, future value plus present value plus 1, or times 1 plus I to the N, and you plug in the values given. Make sure it's 53,000.
Make sure that you understand that when you build these discount factors and these future value factors, if it's 8%, it's 0.08. Okay. If it's 10%, it's 0.1. If it's 5%, it's 0.05. Okay. So you have to make sure that you do that correctly. Okay.
And then for a single period investment, we can determine the balance in an account at the end of a period if we know the interest rate earned on the principal. If the principal of PO is loaned for one period at the interest rate I, the account balance will increase to PO 1 plus I times 1. The term 1 plus I to the N is the future value interest factor or future value factor. And for a two-period investment, it is two consecutive single period loans. Interest earned is added to the account at the end of the first period, and the new account balance is the amount that earns the interest rate I during the second period. The account balance is PO 1 plus I to the 1 at the end of the first period, and PO times 1 plus I to the second at the end of the second period. And here is a graph illustrating just that, from years 1 through 5. So future value and compounding. Here's an example. You deposit $100 $10,000 in a savings account, earning 10% compounded annually for 5 years. How much in the account is in the account at the end of that time? You put the $100 for the present value, and then for the interest rate is 0.10, and then you add one to that, and then since it's 5 years, compounded annually for 5 years, then that's that would be the it would be 2/5. And then here's a graph illustrates a future value of $1 for different periods and different interest rates. So basically, this illustrates the higher the interest rate, the faster the value of an investment will grow, and the larger the amount of money that will accumulate over time. The power of compounding. Compounding more than once a year, the more frequently interest is compounded, the larger the future value of $1 at the end of a given period, time period. If compounding occurs m times within a period, the future value equation becomes future value equals present value times 1 plus I over m to the m times n. So we're just adding the m into the equation. Question problem 5.7 has to do with multiple compounding periods. And it asks to find the future value of a 5-year $100,000 investment that pays 8.75% and that has the following compounding periods. A is quarterly, B monthly, C daily, and D continuous. And here is the equation for 5.7, which is basically what I just said. And then here are the answers. So quarterly for A, you would plug everything into the equation, but since it's quarterly, M would equal 4. So you times that by the value of the investment after 5 years for the exponent. And then for monthly, you would use M equals 12, since obviously there's 12 months in a year. And then that would give you a slightly different answer. And then for daily, you do 365 for M, and it also gives you a different answer. And then for continuous, M would be continuous, so you would put in point E to the point 0.0875 times the years. So for financial calculators, they can easily be done on obviously a financial calculator. Basically, the main point of this is that if you're given any four of these inputs, NI, PV, PMT, or FV, then you can plug it into your calculator and you can get the missing piece. So suppose we lend $5,000 at 15% for 10 years. How much money will we have at the end of that time? So here we see we have N, I, PV, and PMT, and we plug that in the calculator and you can get future value. So tips for using a financial calculator. Use the correct compounding period. Clear the calculator before starting. Use negative signs for cash outflows. Enter interest rates as a percentage. Do not round numbers until calculations are complete. Adjust decimal settings to 4 or more decimal places. And then check the BEG, END modes on your calculator. Use the BEG if it's at the beginning of the period and if it's at the end of the period. So you can also use Excel for these time value of money calculations. So it's the same problem, just shown on Excel. And then present value and discounting. Present value calculation takes end of period cash flows and reverses the effect of compounding to determine the equivalent beginning of period cash flows. So basically, this is discounting, and interest rate I is called the discount rate. Time and the discount rate affect present value. So the greater the amount of time before cash flow is to occur, the smaller the present value of the cash flow. The higher the discount rate, the smaller present value of a future cash flow as well. So the present value discounting equation is present value equals future value sub n over 1 plus I to the n. That's fairly similar to before. It's just you divide by the 1 plus I to the n. And then this is future value and present value compared, just using a diagram. Basically shows that compounding converts a present value into its future value. account the time value of money. And then question 5.10, present estimated present value. Maria and I has been offered a future payment of $750 2 years from now. If she can earn an annual rate of 6.5% compounded daily on her investment, what should she pay for this investment today? And here's the equation that you would use for n. You would obviously use 365 because you're compounding daily, and then you'd plug into this equation and get your answer. And your answer is 657.66. Finding the interest rate. Many situations require using a time value of money calculation to determine a rate of change or growth rate. An investor or analyst may want the growth rate in sales, the rate of return on investment, and then effective interest rate on a loan. So the rule of 72 is a shortcut to estimate the number of periods it takes for an amount to double. So it's fairly accurate for interest rates between 5 and 20%. The time to double your money, TDM, where I is interest rate of return, is TDM equals 72 over I. So basically just put the interest rate under 72. So here's an example. If you can earn 8% compounded annually, how long will it take for you to double your money? TDM equals 72 over I, 8 equals I, 72 over 8 equals 9 years. You could also use this, you also do this using a financial calculator. You're given everything but N itself. So plug everything else in and you get N. Question problem 5.8 has to do with growth rates. Joe Mauer, a catcher for the Minnesota Twins, is expected to hit 15 home runs in 2018. His home run hitting ability is expected to grow by 12% every year for the following 5 years. How many home runs is he expected to hit in 2023? Here's the equation. Is future value equals present value times 1 plus g to the n. And so you plug it into the equation and you get approximately 26 home runs. So here's another calculator example, just illustrating that if you have 4 and you don't have the 5th, you can calculate to get to the 5th one. Same thing as well. So question problem 5.16, the number of periods. You invest $150 in a mutual fund today that pays 9% interest annually. How long will it take to double your money? Here is the same equation. So for this one, I couldn't really change the G to an I, so we just put a little note saying that's still I, it's not G. And then you just plug in all the numbers and you get approximately 8 years for this one. And that's it.
Two problems on the exam. So I'm going to do the dynamic asset class of microeconomics, and also basically apply microeconomics to the asset classes, so that when you start doing the research for the memos, you can use these microeconomic models to be able to forecast where you think the markets are going to go over the next 3 months. And basically all prices, okay, particularly for these large asset classes, price, okay, is the dependent variable. Okay. So the price is basically a multiple regression equation that has all the factors that basically drive price, and price is it, right, at the end of the day. Price drives revenue, price profits, stock prices, bond prices, oil prices, gold prices, and at the end of the day, the value of the U.S. dollar and the value of foreign currency. So basically, at the end of the day, being able to forecast and understand what factors drive these asset classes up and down, you can then formulate your own projections, okay, based on the microeconomic I'm not going to assume that you remember everything from your microeconomics. These are the, this is the approach that you need to kind of burn into your brain and to memorize going forward. And then the second presentation I'm going to do is the financial product innovation and development. These financial institutions are extremely innovative in their approaches to product development. Again, how can you teach a finance class without teaching the underlying foundations of product development? Finance is a technology, okay? You may look at it more as accounting, but it really is a technology that was invented and designed by individuals to solve problems, just like any other product. So finance and financial products, finance and financial process is basically a technology and a tool to basically solve problems. That's it. So if you understand the marketing and the sales and the product development on the technology side, you can apply the exact same methodologies in the finance field. That's all I've been doing for the last 25 years, has basically been working with marketing and sales people to basically design product that solves problems for clients. And it could be building indexes, could be building algorithms, it could be building a lot of different things, could be just building a process of solving a problem. So the process is a technology and a tool. The product is itself is a product and a tool. And if you can create a culture in an environment of product innovation, your teams are going to be developing new products to solve problems on an ongoing basis, and the revenue is going to come in if the market can adopt those products and you can bring those products to market. And you can see now on the tech side, particularly on the startup side, now these people are bringing new products to market and being able to scale in a very short period of time. And if they can do that over and over again, they are basically creating billions of dollars in value for their clients and for themselves and for the marketplaces. Okay, so I'm going to do that application. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to do the microeconomics around the major asset classes, which ties right into the memo. Okay. So the first thing you're going to do is you're going to start off with where the model works. Is we're going to start off with the supply side, and then we're going to go to the demand side. What we're going to do is we start off in equilibrium. Maybe one of these days, some of you may go on to teach in universities, or you may go on to teach internally within the firm. So going through these things and practicing the presentations is extremely important. So we'll start with the supply side, we'll shop the system, and then we'll go into the demand side and shop the system, and we'll come up with the factors that are shocking the system, that you can understand what the impact will be on the price. Okay? So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to look at stocks. Okay? And what we're going to do is we're going to shock the system. And I try to be color coordinated on this, if it works. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to have a negative supply shock, okay, which is going to shift back. The curve, obviously, the quantity supply is going to shift back. And in the process, the price of the stocks are going to rise. Okay. Obviously, you start off in equilibrium. Okay, so now what are the factors that would shift the supply curve back in the stock market? Well, one of the biggest factors, and again, when you start reading these articles and doing these research, they're going to tell you. And one of the biggest things that have been shifting the supply curve back and propping up stock prices, because it hasn't been necessarily from the demand side of the equation that's been propping up the stock prices, it's from stock buybacks. So the stock buybacks would shift the curve back, shift the quantity supply back, and cause the prices of the stock to drop back. So stock buybacks. It's probably the number one. Those corporations have been borrowing very cheap money in the last 10 years. They've levered up the firm. They borrowed a bunch of money, they went into the marketplace, bought their shares back, constrained the marketplace, and propped up their stock prices artificially through an accounting method as opposed to top-line demand for their goods and services generating cash flow and revenue growth rates. So stock buybacks is one of the biggest. I would say maybe reverse stock splits would be another one. But I would say this has been the stock buybacks has been one. Okay. So what would shift the supply curve out for the stocks? So if you shift the supply curve out, quantity supply shifts out, the price of the stocks go down if you increase the supply. So what would be some of the factors that would increase supply of stocks? Well, one would be initial public offerings. Or IPOs. A lot of companies going public. The second would be seasoned or secondary stock issues. Okay. So the market's really good, stock prices are up, companies are going IPO, and existing companies that currently have stocks in the marketplace are issuing even more shares to take advantage of the inflated stock prices. But at some point in time, the appetite for these stocks starts to wane, and too much supply comes into the marketplace, shifting the supply curve out, causing supply to shift out, and causing the price of these stocks to come down from the supply side. On the demand side, okay, let's see if I can do this right. Get my color coordination now. Increasing demand for stocks is going to shift up the demand curve. It's going to cause the quantity demanded for stocks to shift out, and it's going to cause the price of the stocks to go up. So what would be some of the factors that would cause demand for stocks to go up? One is economic growth. Right? So if you have good GDP, everybody's making money, you got money laying around, now they're going to put money in the stock market because they want to save. Okay. So economic growth, about higher economic growth, what else? Oh, higher returns. Higher returns. So if I can make more money in the stock market, I'm going to get out of bonds and I'm going into the stock market because I can make more money. And then how about lower risks? Or macro economic risks, or political risks, or systematic political. So those would be some of the factors that would increase or shift the aggregate demand curve out. What would cause the demand curve to shift down? If the demand curve shifts down, obviously quantity demanded shifts down, and the price of these stocks go down. So what would be some of the factors that would cause stock? You just reverse it, right? You just reverse it. So lower economic growth, lower return, lower return expectations. Returns, lower return expectations. What else? Lower risk, macro risk. You could probably even throw inflation in there too. You could probably even put high interest rates. And I would even put in high inflation. And political instability. People are going to sell off their stocks and go to bonds. There's political instability or global instability. So those are just some of the factors for the stocks, and then the same applies for the oil. And I'll shift to the oil market. So what would cause the supply curve to shift back for oil? I'm going to be throwing these out. If you know them, yell them out.
War in the Middle East?
Yeah, that would be exactly the one. War in the Middle East. How about OPEC? Is OPEC an oligopoly? Do they think on price? If they think that the price is too high, they're probably going to sell in the marketplace. I mean, sorry, but if they think that the price is too low, they're going to cut back on production to try to prop up the prices. Okay. So OPEC also would be involved in that. And definitely war in the Middle East would do. What would shift the supply curve out? Yeah, what is it called? Fracking?
Yeah.
So fracking. Fracking. And then what about substitution effects? Using more electric cars and more sustainable energy as opposed to petroleum based. So maybe we just throw in a technology or alternative energy. Would also push out the existing supply curve. Anything else? What about OPEC? They flood the marketplace to lower oil prices to drive out the frackers, which they did 2 years ago. So OPEC can also be involved. And what about if the United States started to sell off their strategic reserve? Because they hold like billions of barrels, but if they started liquidating the reserve, potentially they could do that too. And then what about, are you guys writing this stuff down? Are you following along, or are you guys writing this, are you guys writing that stuff down? Is your buddy okay with it? Okay, you ready? So how about, what would shift out the aggregate demand curve for oil on a global basis?
More cars, more people.
Yeah, that's not bad. How about population? Economic growth. Employment. Production. India seems to be doing pretty good. China's growing at 7%. The U.S. is growing at 4.1%. So there's definitely higher aggregate demand for oil, and oil is, you know, the major input into all consumption products. Everything you wear, your computer, everything is all petroleum-based from a consumer standpoint. And oil, energy, and fuel is one of the number one transportation inputs in all this production for all companies. So just overall, you know, economic demand. What would cause the demand curve to shut down? Definitely. Technology, what else?
High prices?
Yeah, there could be a price elasticity component.
Yeah.
Price elasticity. How about slow? Low? Negative? Economic growth? Economic growth. Population, employment, production. All of those factors could shift down the demand curve. What about gold? What would cause the gold curve to shift back and supply to shift back and prices to go up in regards to gold? Do people hoard gold?
Yeah.
Central banks hold gold also, not only individuals, but also central banks. Maybe you can come up with some other factors, but I can't really think of too many for the gold. Maybe as you do your research, you'll figure out. What would cause the supply curve to shift out for gold?
Unstable economy?
Supply side.
Oh.
That would probably be more demand.
Yeah.
What would cause the supply of gold to shift out?
Strength and gold.
What?
People strength and gold.
Yeah, more strengths. How about extraction methods? How about new mining methods? Technology, be able to find the gold and then extract the gold efficiently would increase the supply of gold. Or maybe even liquidation. How about liquidation of gold? Central banks, when they run into current account budget deficits, they don't have enough money, you know, to be able to service their dollar-denominated liabilities, will sell off their gold reserves to meet those liabilities. So it could be a sell-off in the marketplace for that. Now, okay, any other ideas on the supply side? Okay, what about demand side? What would cause the demand curve to shift up the ball?
The unstable economy.
Yeah. Instability. Either economic or geopolitical. There's a major political or global unrest, or even a global recession, I'd probably move into safe assets like bonds and gold, okay, and out of stocks, and maybe even out of real estate. What else would cause the demand curve to go? Is gold a commodity? Is gold a commodity?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. Does it track inflation? Gold is a commodity. You know, commodity price inflation. Should there be a correlation between gold prices and inflation?
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So if you see inflation coming in your country, and to preserve your wealth due to the erosion and depreciation of the currency values due to inflation, wouldn't you want to hedge off your risk and go into gold? Because your currency is just, I mean, look at Venezuela, their inflation rate is 9%. So basically, completely worthless currency. So you probably go into it. So geopolitical, inflation, devaluation, all the factors that would drive gold prices up. Demand for gold to go up and prices to go up in bonds. What would cause gold demand to go down and prices to go down? Why don't you just flip it? So stability, economic, geopolitical, how about disinflation? How about appreciation? Revaluation? And currency? Those would all be major factors. Or less purchasing of gold by the central banks. Here we could have purchasing. Oops. Those are all the factors. And you may, as you're reading, you're going to come up with more. As you read the financial news, you're going to come up with other factors along with these are just the main factors. What would shift the supply curve back for bonds, particularly government bonds? Even though we've only seen them during the Clinton administration. Years ago, when you run budget surpluses, you're not issuing as much bonds. And you're probably retiring some of those and buying back those bonds to basically retire the bonds. maturity. Most of the bonds that are out there are short-term bonds. We don't need any more bonds. We're not going to issue any bonds. And actually, they're hitting the maturity dates. So they're basically taking themselves out at the end of maturity dates. So as these start to roll, we're not replacing them. So there'd be less supply of bonds, just based as they mature. Okay, did you have a question? Anybody have any others? Okay. What would cause the supply curve to shift down? Our favorite. Budget deficits. We don't have enough tax revenue to basically pay for all of the expenditures, so basically we have to issue bonds. Okay. What about another one up here? How about foreign? So, we talked that China's going to be mad at us for imposing 20% tariffs on basically $1 trillion. So, in retaliation, we're going to stop or liquidate some of their treasuries, which will pump treasuries in the marketplace, cause the supply curve to shift down, prices to go down, and interest rates to go up. Okay. And the majority of our debt, almost 50% of our debt, is controlled by foreigners. So, kind of gives you an idea of where we are there. Those are really the only things I can think of. What would cause demand for bonds to go up? Low and falling inflation and interest rates. Those are probably one of the biggest. How about fear? Either economic, geopolitical. How about a recession? Those are all factors. People out of the stock market and other asset classes into safe, liquid U.S. government treasury securities, risk-free securities. What about what would cause the demand curve to shift back? Or actually, another one here that would cause the demand curve to shift out could be demographic. As people start to retire, as they get older, they want to buy, they shift out stocks and bonds, and then they start buying longer dated bonds to basically provide the coupon payments that they can live off of, and then the principal amounts will come due at the end of maturity that they can live off during their retirement, so you can use bonds from a demographic standpoint. So what would cause the demand curve to shift down? Higher rising inflation. Could be negative demographic trends. Could be, let's say, how about peace and stability? If I'm feeling good and the world's pretty peaceful and we're in an economic growth phase of the business cycle and we're getting a lot of wealth, why would I be buying lower interest, lower yielding bonds when I can take the risk and go into higher stocks? That's what I would do. And then growth phase. And also higher earnings expectations. If the economy is growing and if the economy is going to continue to grow, then firms are going to sell more product, generate more revenue growth, more cash flow growth, more earnings growth, and that earnings growth expectations are going to push their stock prices higher. Last one is the value of the dollar. How much time do I have? do the dollar, we're not doing prices of the dollar, we're doing values. You got to change inflation to values. Because there's no price of the dollar, the price of a euro, it's the value of the dollar and the value of the euro. You got to change the inflation. So what would cause the supply curve to shift back? $1.41. Precautionary balances. People hold a lot of cash these days. They've been through the recession and the Great Depression. They don't want to go through it again, so they're holding a lot of cash. So they're hoarding their dollars. So that'll cause the supply curve to shift. Another one could be higher interest rates. Starts to sell off the bonds to drive down bond prices and drive up interest rates. When they're selling off the bonds, they're swapping bonds for cash, right? And they're taking cash out of the economy. So the Fed starts to sell off the bonds into the marketplace. And there's an exchange for bonds for cash, and they're taking cash out. That could shift the supply curve back to on the shift the supply curve out, more dollars, how about Fed printing? Running budget deficits, we need to print more money, stimulate the economy. So when the Fed prints money, it's injecting liquidity into the system. So that could push the supply curve out. What would increase the demand for the dollar?
Appreciates.
Yeah. How about what would be just overall appreciation expectations? What would drive appreciation or higher demand for the dollar? Low inflation. Inflation differentials. I think the inflation rate in the United States is going to be lower than someplace else. That means someplace else's currency is depreciating quickly while ours isn't in relative terms. So I'm going to dump their currency and buy ours because I'm preserving my wealth because our inflation rate is less. Let's see, how about higher interest rates? Differentials. If I can get a higher rate of return here in the United States than in Japan, I'm going to dump the yen and I'm going to buy the dollar because I can get a higher rate of return on the bonds. How about higher expected returns? If I can get higher expected returns in the stock market, the real estate market, and the bond market in the United States, I'm going to dump the foreign currency and I'm going to buy the U.S. dollar. Oh, another would be higher labor productivity. I'm a business and I want to invest on a global platform, and I think that labor productivity here in the United States is higher than someplace else. If I can get higher labor productivity here, I can probably get higher profit margins. I don't want my goods that I produce. So higher labor productivity would also increase the demand for the currency. Any other factors here? I think these are just their major ones. And then what would cause the demand curve to go down? Depreciation. Devaluation expectations. When China devalued its currency 10% in 2016, almost $1 trillion a year started flowing out of China into the because they thought there was going to be continuous devaluations. So they got out.
On the positive demand for U.S. dollar,
yes.
Would a potential factor be if there's a big baby boom and just about everybody's ready to enter the workforce?
I was thinking more of the supply and demand for dollars on a global basis.
Okay.
Statically, but theoretically, if there's more people out there,
it would improve productivity in general because there's so much.
There's that, but if there's more people, then they're going to need more money. Right?
That's true. Okay.
Even on a global basis.
Yeah.
So there would be more demand for the currency if it's the right currency.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I would also say increasing demand would be. Low political risk. People invest in the United States because of enforcement of private property rights is rare in some, a lot of companies, and we have a relatively stable political system too. So country risk, low country risk. These are all going to create capital flows, capital flight, capital inflows into the U.S. dollar. Capital flight out of foreign countries, capital inflows into the United States. So you want to write those terminologies down. Capital flight, money out of foreign countries into the United States, and capital inflows into the United States because of the demand curve to shift up. And then depreciation and devaluation expectations would cause the demand curve to go down. High inflation. Low interest rates. Low return expectations. Particularly in the stock, bond, real estate market. And then low labor productivity. You may come up with other factors that will influence where the direction of the asset class prices are going to go and the value of the currencies are going to go. Okay. How much time do I have?
7 minutes.
What is it?
7 minutes.
Seven?
Or six.
Six? Okay. You might want to take a picture of this.
Four.
Okay. Yeah, because I don't have much. I've already sent you this, and I'll go over this again on Tuesday. Okay, we'll finish. Trying to finish the exam, you know, work on the problems on the exam. But I'll take my 3 minutes or 2 minutes to do a kind of a quick introduction of this. Basically, this lays out the institutional infrastructure that needs to be in place to do product innovation and product development in the finance world. It can be public or private equity firms, could be venture capital firms, could be financial institutions, finance companies, could be fintech, finance tech companies that are now entering the space. And the fintech companies, the fintech divisions within these larger institutions that are involved in this. What you need to be able to do, what these companies do, is they constantly monitor the market. They constantly monitor change in the market. And the change can come from external or demographic sources, could come from re-regulation or deregulation in the marketplaces. So you look at, for example, if you look at the financial institutional structures, the organizational structures of these financial institutions, they're significantly different than where they were pre-financial crisis as opposed to post-financial crisis. So the financial crisis in itself was the number one factor to restructure and reorg these financial institutions due to re-regulation and significant changes in the marketplace. So you're all going to be working in these companies. You're going to be subjected to change. The question is, does the company promote a culture, a psychological culture for change? Do do you have charismatic leaders within the company that can be used as models to move through this self-efficacy process on a personal or on a group level that promotes product innovation internally within the firm? If not, if the firm is not structured correctly, the organizational structure doesn't match. And the market structure of the company is myopic. It is subjected to failure. It doesn't promote internal creativity and innovation from a product standpoint. They're not going to develop products to meet the market demands in a rapidly changing environment. So they're not going to be as profitable. And at some point in time, if they're not profitable, either they're going to go bankrupt or somebody's going to buy them out at some point when their share price falls significantly beyond their intrinsic value or their book value. The last two models for revenue growth, and I'll get into it a little bit more. Maybe S-curves, what we learned from your operations research. Technology companies are extremely successful, particularly the ones that have been around a long time, have continued to develop new technologies consistently over time, meeting the market demand and growing the revenue consistently and constantly over time, maximizing the value of the firm. Then you have other firms that are extremely innovative, especially now tech companies that can enter the marketplace very quickly with social media and network technologies. Now, I can get my technology to be adopted very quickly, faster than ever before, and you can move from the innovator to early majority adoption very quickly. And if you're a firm that can innovate new technologies consistently over time and respond to the marketplace, also be a company that can innovate new products consistently and meet the market demand very quickly, then you can produce new products going forward, new technologies going forward, generate and maximize revenue growth, and maximize the value of the firm and the share price to the stockholders and the stakeholders. That's the goal. So we'll talk a little bit more about this on Tuesday. But again, when you're initiating these product development cycles, when you run an R&D division within the company, when you spend money in marketing and advertising campaigns and product development, it's going to cost you money. Okay? So you have to do the internal rate of return and the present value and the net present value and the break-even analysis, which is what you're going to learn in this class if you don't already know it. And you're going to, your marketing programs, your advertising campaigns, and your product development campaigns are going to be scrutinized using capital budgeting techniques. And if your net present value is significantly positive and your internal rate of return and modified internal rate of return is higher than the cost of capital and your break-even is less than a year, they're going to approve your project and you're going to develop the product to meet the market demand. If you can do that consecutively and consistently over time, you're going to be extremely successful. Okay, so you have to understand the finance, you got to understand the marketing, you got to understand the ops, you got to understand the management, you got to understand the finance, you got to understand the accounting, because the top people understand all that stuff. They can move across divisions and up and down the firms and out of the firms. They're very fluid and very flexible. Okay, so I'll talk a little bit more about this later. And then we'll move through, start working some of the problems on this. Thank you very much. And if you have any memos you want to show me, I'd be more than happy to take them.
Did we even turn it on? Was it ever even
I think it was on.